Hey everybody, this is Jorge Rivera, FirstCoast.tv. I just wanted to share this little story. I was at the Lincolnville Museum and Cultural Center, and they have this new exhibition, Women that Made a Difference. It's about women who made a difference from the Lincolnville area. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful exhibition. So I had a conversation with the executive director, Regina Gale Phillips, and she talked a little bit about it. The camera was struggling with the light in the room. It's a museum, the spotlights, and also the reflection out of the exhibition screen. But, you know, it survived. There's enough information there to get you curious. Listen, become a member of the Lincolnville Museum and Cultural Center. It's probably the best thing you'll do in your life. That place has really been transformed, and it's looking just fantastic. If you haven't been there in a while, you're missing a lot. You need to go by. You need to support this exhibition. You need to become a member. And this exhibition was just wonderful. So I'll let you watch and let Regina Gale Phillips explain what it's all about. Okay, so tell us a little bit about this exhibition.
So we just selected five women from our archives and from the community that...
And what community are we talking about? This is going to go worldwide, okay. You know, they're going to see
from
this
the Lincolnville
in Ukraine.
Community. Lincolnville, you know, is one of those freedmen towns that started after the Civil War. So this is a part of our legacy, 155-year-old community.
Here in Florida.
Mm-hmm. Here in St. Augustine, Florida, the oldest city in the nation. We're here at the Lincolnville Museum, which is inside the first high school for blacks in St. John's County. So these ladies all were connected in some way to the Excelsior School. Four of them actually attended school here, and the fifth one, Mildred Larkins, was a teacher here.
Okay, but so the Excelsior School is where we're at now,
absolutely.
And it's a museum now. Mm-hmm. But once it was a school where these five women attended them.
Right, and they all graduated from here with the exception of Miss McDade, who left at the age of 17, mm-hmm. and went off to New York pursuing fame and fortune in the entertainment industry.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
they all grew up here. This lady was not born here, Kat Twine, but she became a very integral part of the community. She was very vocal and prolific in the civil rights movement, as was Miss Vickers, who helped to establish the monument in our plaza downtown for the foot soldiers.
Okay.
Jamie Price was a friend of Dr. King. She was a nurse. She went to nursing school in Atlanta and met him while he was a student at Morehouse. Miss Twine was also a nurse. And so, you know, we have teachers and nurses, and this lady was a beautician. She did all kinds of different things. She's still alive. She's 98 years old. She just
wow.
had a birthday. And she is awesome. She's a dynamite lady. So she's kind of like the big cover story here because there's so much that she's done. And when we ask her what was the most exciting thing that she had done, she actually said the Foot Soldiers Monument.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go to some of her civil rights stuff. And she was involved in some of the sit-ins in St. Augustine at the churches and stuff because she said she was so busy working, she had to work. And if I go back...
And it's so interesting because when I listened to what she was saying, it always seemed like she didn't want to get involved, but it always pulled her in.
And Dr. King, you know, called her out. Young lady, what about you?
Uh-huh.
So she ended
and
up...
And it's so interesting how much she did by being so reluctant, yet
uh-huh.
she did so much.
Yeah, and then even didn't stop, even as uh-huh. a senior citizen.
Right.
This monument that she did was unveiled in 2014, I want to say.
Not too long ago.
So, you know, she's in her 80s and she's still doing
mm-hmm.
stuff. So
mm-hmm.
she's still here and
That's
still
amazing.
Doing a lot of different things. But, you know, we just take you through her life. She was one of those young women that was a Rosie the Riveter. So she went off to New York
yes.
also. Several
right.
of them went to New York.
Yeah.
So that's another
working
thing we have
in
common.
Working on the ships.
Working on the ships. This is a picture from Florida Normal College that was
mm-hmm.
here, a training class that they had. She gets the name Vickers from a man who was also another famous person from St. Augustine. He was a basketball coach. Behind you, there's a little tribute to him as part of the Fabulous Four from FAMU mm-hmm. in the 1950s. But there's a park named after him and so forth.
Right.
So she kept that name. One of the other interesting things that she did was she took a trip to Rome. Well, that's actually just going back to the
Foot Soldiers. Yes, that's the Foot Soldiers Monument. Mm-hmm.
But she, and this is the unveiling with Dr. Right. Helen in the plaza. But she took a trip to Rome for the canonization of Sister Drexel, Catherine Drexel. And she and a couple other ladies from the community, Miss White and another lady from Jacksonville that accompanied them, Ella Simmons. And so she did so many different things. But we just like being able to tell the stories. My favorite is still the childhood story when she talks about playing with the doodle bugs. Mm-hmm. And she wrote a story about it, and we found an interview that she did with Flagler College students at the Chris Ellert Museum, and we've included excerpts from that in here as well with her talking about playing with the doodle bugs. So a lot of wonderful stories.
So let me stop you right here. This great place to stop is, how long do you think it would take a person to go through the whole exhibition? If they had a whole day off, there's several hours.
There are several hours. If they watched all the videos and stuff, mm-hmm. obviously we don't want people to do all of that at one time, because one person can interact with you at a time.
Right.
So, you know, we figure if you know, most people are going to spend 10 to 15 minutes. Right. You know, they may not be interested in every single detail.
Well, if this is successful in the future, you can have several of these screens in this place where...
That's the idea, is to be able to offer more exhibits like this, because... Right. You know, even though we're in a building that used to be a high school and it's pretty large, but it's still not large enough to show all the stories we want to tell, 450 plus years of history.
The history is much bigger than the building.
Absolutely. So we have another one actually coming in November that is being put together by Teresa Siegel, which is about the gentrification of Lincolnville. Okay. So that's going to debut in November, and it's going to be over there. We're going to rearrange that part of the museum a little bit. Right. It won't be the same kiosk, but it'll be the same kind of format in terms of an interactive screen.
What do you hope people leave with when they interact with this? They spend, say, 20 minutes with it. What do you hope it does to their psyche or their knowledge?
I hope that they will... say, you know, these were not extraordinary women. They were ordinary women who did extraordinary things just because they cared. They cared about their community. They cared about their families. They cared about, you know, pursuing dreams that were, you know, not even, you know, imaginable for some people. You know, to leave your hometown, little tiny St. Augustine, and go to New York to pursue a dream.
Right.
Or to go with no real plan like Ms. Vickers did. You know, she was just like, you know, she was a real Renaissance woman. You know, it's like, I'm going. She didn't have a job lined up. She didn't have any of those things. So she just went, and she not only went to New York, she did the same thing, went to Seattle, Washington.
Right.
So, you know,
she's working for Boeing, I think, or something out there.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so they all did those kinds of things. Miss Twine, who would, you know, say, hey, I know I may get arrested today one more time, so I'm going to be ready. She had her backpack. She had her sun hat ready. And that even though her husband was the head of the NAACP, she was that strong woman beside him doing things. And also... she was also outstanding in her profession. If you talk to people who knew her, who worked with her, you know, even before we started doing this project, people go, oh yeah, I worked with Miss Kat. And you know, they would have these, you know, glowing stories to share. This lady was a single mother who, you know, went off to New York as a young woman, married up there, had two children, came back, had the third one, who ended up being the superintendent of schools for the whole county. And but her husband had a dream that was, you know, separated him from her. He left her with these three boys that she ended up rearing. And she did that as a single mother. And then later she remarried in life. But, you know, she took them to work with her when she was a teacher in a one-room schoolhouse. And, you know, so there was like courage and determination is
I feel that these women were determined to make reality the America that the whites were talking about, the land of the free, the land of the brave, the freest country in the world. It didn't apply to them, you see, and they just kept pushing the envelope to say, this dream has to include everybody, you know,
That's true.
and the sacrifices that they had and what they had to endure. Because I listened to some of them with the stuff they had to endure in an apartheid system, really, because that's what it was.
It was in the height of Jim Crow, right. When you think about it. Mm-hmm. It was like this period between, we just have it on a timer so that it times out. It's the period between Jim Crow and Reconstruction,
right.
Where their parents, who were some of them descendants of enslaved people, you know, and so they have this vision of like, we're gonna really make it big. So the fact that this school, like in that picture over there, was at the center. Mm-hmm. You know, they had a brand new schoolhouse, two-story schoolhouse, Mediterranean style, which was like nothing in this community, to be honest with you. And so this is where they got to come and be instilled by teachers like Mildred, who just inspired them to do great things. And there are so many stories of people who came through this community that, you know, she impacted. And who, you know, Ms. Vickers, she talks about how she, some of her clients or some of her teachers, when she was a cosmetology teacher, that she would like actually counsel them on you know, their relationships and their personal lives and the impact that made. And, you know, so it's, this lady talked about how she would be called in the middle of the night by women who couldn't afford a doctor, and she'd go out and deliver babies or, you know, help to take care of sick people. Because that was her passion, that was always there. And I hope when kids come that they'll see, when they listen to her, especially Janie's story, that they'll see she always knew what she wanted to do.
Yes.
You know? This lady always knew what she wanted to do when she was a little kid singing.
Right, but what amazed me was when she quit her job, because she realized that white nurses who had much less education than her were making much more than she was, and she just quit.
So
and
the
she
principal.
Became a private, she became a private nurse, you know? But it's just that, why quit your job?
I mean,
that's so, especially being a person of color, knowing that you only get jobs at the mercy of the whites.
Yeah.
The whites give you those jobs.
But their attitude was just like, you can't stop me.
Right, right.
You know, and that's what I think is really amazing is that you really couldn't.
Well, thank you for this little time in front of this. I hope there are lines out the door to get to this screen. And, you know, this is great. This is great.
All right. Thanks. Well, thank you for your help. I mean, we really couldn't have done it without all of the people who chipped in.
It's
you know,
we
like had friends like coming out of the woodwork to help us. So
it's a teamwork.
Yeah.
I was, for me, it was an honor. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.